Welcome to the Microsoft Virtual Academy. Thanks for joining us today. This session we will cover the Orchestrator architecture. Here is the agenda for this session, and then we will go right into the architecture, and we will also cover the tools that are available with Orchestrator and how you are going to use them. And then we will also talk a little bit about the connectivity stuff, so which ports are going to be used in an Orchestrator environment, a little bit about the security as well, and about redundancy. So from an architecture perspective, you see a couple of those terms that I've described already. You see the management server that will communicate between the Orchestrator runbook designer and the database itself. The runbook servers on the very top of that picture are going to communicate with the database itself. And then one part I didn't mention in the terms section was the Orchestrator web service. We have a REST-based web service that is configured by default on port 81. And that REST-based web service can be used by third-party solutions as well as the orchestration console. So the orchestration console is actually, it's a web application that's by default on port 82. And you're able to use that in a browser to control your runbooks and also get real-time information about the runbooks and the status of that runbooks. So one sample of a runbook, how it can look like, and that's very very simple example, but I think you get the idea of that. So you have a graphical user interface that's going to be provided by the runbook designer, and you're able to grab the activities from the toolbox, put it on the surface, and using those links to bring that activities together. And what you see here on the left is the initialized data activity where you define the parameters that will be used by that runbook. And then you have a couple of activities, for example, generate random password that do what it says. Actually, it generates a random password, and then it uses the activity that we saw already, the create user activity that will probably, you cannot see it here, but it will probably take parameters that are part of the initialized data and also use the output of the generate random password activity to create a user in the Active Directory. Below that, you'll see the error handler activity. That's actually an activity that calls another runbook, which actually does some error handling techniques. And on the right, it will go to grab a group, and depending on if the user is already in that group, it will add the user to the existing group, or if that group doesn't exist, it will create that group and then add that user to the new group. And at the very end, it will enable that user in Active Directory. So that's a pretty simple example of a runbook, how it can look like, and I think that will give you an idea how that works. So what are the stages of a runbook? First of all, an administrator creates a runbook in the designer. So you're going to use the runbook designer to really create that runbook. Then he has to check in that to the database, and then he's able to start that runbook. He can do that actually from the designer, within the designer, or you're able to do that within the console, the orchestrator console. This actually, as soon as someone clicks on the Start Runbook button, this will create a job in the database, and a runbook server is actually monitoring for new jobs that occur in the database. And as soon as that happens and the runbook sees that new job, it will actually grab the runbook, copies that runbook locally to the runbook server, and then starting processing the runbook. And of course, the runbook server will pass back to the database information like status, activity results, and data, and stores that into the database of Orchestrator. So we've talked a little bit already about the tools, which tools are available. The orchestration console, actually where you can control the runbooks, you're able to start, to stop them, you see some real-time status, and that's all part of a web browser application. Then we have the Orchestrator web service. That's the REST-based service that really enables custom application and third-party applications to connect to Orchestrator and work with the Orchestrator runbooks, as well as the orchestration console that also uses the same REST-based web service. Then we have a couple of other tools, the Deployment Manager. That tool actually helps you to deploy Orchestrator components, like if you want to deploy a new runbook server, or you want to deploy a new designer, or you want to install a new integration pack, no matter if it's from Microsoft or a third-party vendor, you're using the Deployment Manager to import that and deploy those components to your orchestration environment. The Runbook Tester, it's actually a runtime tool that you can use to test runbooks. So you, if you're familiar with testing in Visual Studio, for example, it gives you very very same experience where you're able to really debug your runbooks step by step and activity by activity to see what's going on in your runbook. So from a connectivity perspective, I don't want to go into much detail here. That's just for reference here that you're able to look at that if you are going to set your orchestrator architecture in your data center. There are different ports that must be enabled to make the communication happen between the different components within Orchestrator. Talk a little bit about service accounts and permission. There are two important accounts here. First of all, it's the management server account. That's important for maintaining database, for communicating with the designers and the deployment manager. And it must be part of the admin role in the orchestration database. One more important account here, service account, is the runbook server account. Actually, that's the one that will be used by default by all activities that will use that runbook server account. You can configure that differently by defining that on the activities, but by default, this runbook server account is used by all activities. And it's recommended to be a domain account so that you're able to span your workflows across machines and environments. A short slide about redundancy. From a data store perspective, you're using SQL Server, which is central to the Orchestrator functionality. So that's one of the most important parts of your Orchestrator environment. So we have all the high availability configuration available, and it's really recommended to use clustering for your data store, for example. Runbook servers, it's possible to deploy multiple runbook servers, not only to increase capacity, but also to provide redundancy in your environment, and actually the failover, if there's a runbook server failure, that will happen automatically as soon as you have more than one runbook server available. The runbooks, you better perform exports periodically as backup. And you should also include error handling and redundancy on an object level within the runbooks. And all the other components like the designer, deployment manager, license manager, and the operator console are design time components and do not really require redundancy at that point in time. So I've mentioned integration packs a couple of times already, so it's time to have a look on that as well. So that's part of the way to extend Orchestrator. So an integration pack is actually, it's a collection of custom activities specific to a product or technology. So Microsoft provides a couple of integration packs, for example, for System Center 2012 components, but also for others, and other companies are providing integration packs as well to make it possible to interact with their products within a runbook. And on the right side, the screenshot you see here is actually, that's the activity pane within Orchestrator. You see a couple of activities that are there out of the box, like system, scheduling, monitoring, file management, and so on. But you also see a couple of integration packs that were imported after installation of Orchestrator, like the SC 2012 Operations Manager integration pack. And below you see a couple of activities that are part of that integration pack for Operations Manager. So integration packs really is one way to extend Orchestrator. Another way is using the Orchestrator integration toolkit, which extend the library of activities. It's actually a wizard-based tool to create new activities and use and bundle those activities to integration packs. And developers are also able to use the Orchestrator SDK to create integration packs to build some custom activities as well. And they will show up the same way as integration pack will do in that screenshot. So now I would like to drive through those System Center 2012 integration packs. So for the Operations Manager, you see you have a couple of alert-specific activities. For example, you're able really easily to create alerts, to get alerts, to monitor for a specific alert. You're able to start the maintenance mode, for example, or stop the maintenance mode, or you're also able to update an alert. For example, so those are parts of the System Center Operations Manager 2012 integration pack. For Configuration Manager, you have a couple of collection-specific rules, for example, to create, to delete a collection. You're able to add members to a specific collection. You're able to deploy applications, you're able to deploy updates or task sequence, and you can also perform some client action within the Configuration Manager IP. For Service Manager, you have also a whole bunch of activities, for example, to create objects, to create incidents, to create changes using templates that you've defined in Service Manager. Then you can create a relationship between those objects or delete them. You have a couple of get activities like get object, get relationship, and you're also able to update objects and specifically activity and attachment. There are specific activities for that as well. So for Virtual Machine Manager, you're able to create a whole bunch of stuff like creating new disks, creating user roles, creating virtual machines, both from templates, from VHD or from VMs. You have a couple of get activities, but you're also able to really control your virtual machines, to shut down virtual machine, to start, to stop, to pause them. And you're able to update stuff like network adapters, disks, and virtual machines. For Data Protection Manager, you're able to create recovery points. You're able to protect data sources, and you're also able to recover different workloads like SharePoint, SQL, and virtual machines. So a couple of more integration packs besides the System Center 2012 components. There is an Active Directory integration pack. There are some HP integration packs available for their Operations Manager, for IBM Tivoli, and also for VMware vSphere. There's also an integration pack that Microsoft provides. And that's actually on the right side you see the link where you're able to download those integration packs to import them into your environment. And there is a whole bunch of other integration packs available from third-party vendors like BMC, CA, HP, IBM, Symantec, VMware, HP, I mentioned that already, EMC, and that's also the URL to download those integration packs to use them in your environment. So with that, we are almost at the end of that first session about Orchestrator. I would like to give you a short summary of what we've covered in that first session. First of all, we had a look on the architecture of Orchestrator, of all the components that are part of that. We did a review of the use cases. We had a look on every component and service within Orchestrator. I give you a quick view on the component connectivity requirements and also about security, as well as we've discussed redundancy in the Orchestrator architecture. And of course, we did a review of integration packs and how you're able to extend Orchestrator with those integration packs. So with that, I would like to close that first session, but I would like also to give you a quick sidestep to all the different material that is available. First of all, on TechNet Eval Center, you're able to download free trial versions of Microsoft software. There are no feature limits, and it's all at no cost. So go there at technetmicrosoft.com/evalcenter. IT Champs, it's actually also at no cost, hands-on technical training events for IT pros. You will find that on technetmicrosoft.com/globalitchamps. And last but not least, it's the Microsoft Virtual Academy that offers free online technical trainings. And you'll find that on microsoftvirtualacademy.com. So that's it for this session. Thanks for joining us today and hope to see you soon.